This is the 1811 Bolton and Watt Canal Pump. I'm Darren, and this is the Industrial Revolution. Built in the Bolton and Watt Soho Works in England around 1811, this canal pump operated for the Birmingham Canal Navigation Company, pumping water from lower levels up to higher levels. This is a common requirement for canal operations, especially in areas that didn't have a lot of flowing streams that you could dam off to divert water. Every time you lowered a ship through a lock, you lost a whole lock full of water. You had to replace that water at the top. Either you fed that through streams, through a diverted river, or you installed one of these and pumped the water back up. And that's what this was built for. But like all of James Watt's engines, this one actually operated at very low steam pressure. It operated about 5 psi or so. And as such, it's an atmospheric engine. It relied on creating a vacuum in order to sort of pull the piston back down. It's actually atmospheric pressure plus, in some cases, a little bit of steam pressure combining to push, since you can't really pull with a vacuum. The heart of the engine is the steam-jacketed 36-inch cylinder. The outside's actually about 4 feet, so you've got maybe 6 inches all the way around your steam cylinder, or your main cylinder for the steam jacket. That keeps the system hot and prevents condensation from occurring inside, which would cut down efficiency. That was one of the ways that Watt was able to greatly increase efficiency. This pipe coming down on the left here, that was the steam inlet. And here it goes up to this manifold at the top. The manifold connects both top and bottom because unlike the canal pump that we've talked about before from James Watt, this one actually is a double-acting cylinder and actually includes most of the newer innovations which he later created in various other engines. First one, and this is set up in a great position, we can actually see the actual valve assembly here. This is the valve assembly for the lower part. When this is moved in one direction, it lets steam in. And when it's moved in the other direction, steam will actually go out of it from the bottom, drain down this pipe here and go into that large metal cylinder at the bottom. That's the condensing cylinder. This well that we see, this dry, dusty brick well, that would have originally been full of water, which would have kept that cold. Here we see the plug tree. This narrower vertical rod. You have the oval-shaped pieces bolted to it, and that connects with these levers on the sides. The levers could be operated manually, and you did that to start the system. Once it was running, the plug tree would actually keep it running automatically for you. That rod is connected at the top to the overhead beam. And the timing was set up so that it would open and close the valves automatically at the right time and keep the pump running until you actually stopped it by turning off the steam. These are common on all Watt and Newcomen type engines. Later they were replaced cosmetically. If you think of a steam train you might have seen with the all the connecting rods and stuff spinning around connecting to the wheels, it does the same thing. So it's a bit decorative, which is kind of uncommon, although it's becoming more common at this point. But the large rectangular box here actually routed both the input steam and the output exhaust. Steam came in, I said about 5 psi or so. When you wanted to exhaust the steam, you would open the valve at the other end, and that would connect again down to the bottom through this outlet pipe and into the condenser. The other thing you see here is your feed water pump. So as for innovations, this is actually a double-acting cylinder. His previous canal pumps were single-acting. You see at the top, you have a parallel motion. On earlier pump designs, you'd actually run chains across an arc there so that whatever position the top of the beam was in, it would be directly over the center of the cylinder, because you can't move the piston rod back and forth. It has to keep going straight up and down. So instead you had this fairly complex set of rods here that allow you to keep the piston rod going straight up and down despite the arc being formed by the beam. And the beam, in fact, as you can see looking up through it, is actually a steel beam and not a wood beam, unlike his previous engine. Here at the pump end, we once again have a parallel motion, and here we can see a little better, it's not obstructed. Fairly complex, just to get around the fact that here too, the pump shaft has to go straight up and down, and the end of your beam does form an arc. This comes down the pump shaft, all the way to the bottom, and down into the lower water entry point. In this case, it brings the water up and puts it into the spillway, where it spills out into the upper level of the canal. Here we can get a look at just how massive these beams actually are on these large steam engines. It's a huge steel beam. And you see the wooden logs at both ends. That's actually to stop the motion when it reaches the end of stroke. Look at that little box in the center. Well, that's kind of a unique feature on this engine. That's a cumulative stroke counter. So it counts how many strokes were actually conducted by this engine. Unfortunately, I don't have the number, but it operated for a long, long time. So chances are more than that stroke counter was able to track. So as we look at James Watt's 1811 canal pump here in the foreground and his 1796 canal pump in the background, you might be wondering, why did he make this change? Why did he switch from single acting cylinder to a double acting cylinder? Why did he change from a wood beam to a steel beam? Why did he change from simple change to parallel motion? Well, you might think, well, it was better, but it wasn't really. They both pumped about the same amount of water. The newer version, because it's a double-acting cylinder and had to provide steam to both the top and the bottom of the cylinder, probably actually used a little bit more steam, in fact, so it cost a little bit more to run. Did the addition of the parallel motion help? Well, no, that was really just a requirement, because when you switch from single-acting to double-acting on a beam engine, you have to use something like a parallel motion. You can't push on a chain, of course. So why was it done? Well, there's two possible explanations. The first is this is simply what Watt was making at the time, and you just couldn't buy the old stuff anymore. Well, that does seem somewhat unlikely. The second explanation is something we might be a little more familiar with today. We all know people who go out and they buy the best, fastest possible computer they can find, and they use it to surf the web. We all know people who go out and they buy the absolute newest, most expensive iPhone they can every single year, even though their old one was working just fine. And that may be the reason for this, for all these enhancements on this 1811 canal pump. No matter what the reason, though, engines like this and the technology represented here, they really got us where we are today. And that's why this is the Industrial Revolution. Before you go, I do need your help. There's two things you can do. Number one is help YouTube get more people to the channel. Easiest way you can do that, completely free, hit like on the video, subscribe to the channel, and best of all, you can comment more than just two or three words. That tells YouTube, you know, this video is good, the channel's good, send more people here. Second thing you can do, each of these videos ends up being pretty expensive to actually produce. Obviously, it's hours of work for each one, but I also have to actually drive to the locations. And if it's far enough away, I have to spend a night in order to do all the on-location filming that I do for these videos, that I think is essential for the videos. If you can help out financially, either with a super thanks, or if you can help out over at patreon.com/industrialrevolution, that'll help me to extend my range even further, get out to more and better sites, and bring you even better videos. Thanks for watching. Look forward to seeing you next time.